Okay, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
It seems to be picking me up just fine. That's great. Thank you, everyone, for coming out today. I really appreciate it, especially this is a very appropriate time for us to be holding this event, but also at the same time means there's many other events that are competing for our attention this weekend. So I appreciate that you took the time to be here with us this morning. As Kohara-sensei mentioned, I have been involved in Jodo Shinshu for quite some time. I actually got my start here in New York, here at this temple, back in the 1990s, and I met Kohara-sensei 10 years ago in Kyoto. Right? It was about 10 years ago when at the Hokusai Center that we first met, so we've had a good friendship for quite some time. My talk here is based in part on that same-sex marriage research, which Sensei mentioned, and I will include some of that here today. But as I started thinking about what I could say this morning, I had many ideas about things that I wanted to draw your attention to. So I'm going to be doing a sort of a larger topic here, what I'm calling a queer history of Buddhism. And I want to define my terms right at the start here, so we understand what it is that I'm trying to say. Pardon me. So, this is queer is one of those words that falls partially under the category that Amy was just talking about words that people may have different understandings of or different reactions to. If you're from an older generation, this is a word which was often used in a pejorative manner, and it may feel hurtful to have this sort of word thrown around. On the other hand, for people of my generation and younger, queer was basically reclaimed by the community. And in fact, queer studies or queer theory, which is going to be the underlying sort of academic approach I take here today, this is something that's been an accepted part of the academy for about 25 years at this point. So that's the environment that I come from, and so that's sort of my relationship with this term here. So let me just be totally clear what we are talking about when we talk about use of this word queer and a queer history of Buddhism. So queer, essentially, this is a definition taken from the work of Judith Butler, who's really the pioneering person in queer studies. She's a University of California, Berkeley professor who back in the 1990s began to develop this sort of thing. So queer really refers to persons, groups, or ideas that don't fit into dominant notions, especially obviously ones of sex, gender, or social arrangements, parents, this sort of thing, in a society. And therefore, things that are queer in this manner call those things into question, force us to think them through again, and allow for possible shifts or realignments here, right? So essentially here, queer is a technical term, and it also basically has a positive connotation because it suggests that things that are queer aren't just different, but by virtue of being different, they allow us to rethink things in ways that are potentially helpful. Okay, so that's one of the main ways in which this term is going to be employed in this talk here. I have to say also, queer is also just these days a catch-all term for anybody who falls under LGBTQI, all that stuff, right? So I'll use that as shorthand occasionally too, because it's a lot easier than listing off all the acronyms, right? So that's what I'm doing here today, just to establish my terms. Okay, let me try to advance this. Oops. That one, great. Okay, all right. This is the last slide, I think, that doesn't have a picture on it, so the rest of the talk will be more interesting, I promise. All right, so Jodo Shinshu, just quickly. We're fortunate to have many people from the Jodo Shinshu community, including not only New York, but further afield here as well. But also, I'm very glad that we have some people from beyond that community as well. So if there's anyone who's unfamiliar with this, I just want to very quickly mention what this is that we're talking about here today. So Jodo Shinshu is one type of Buddhism. There are many types of Buddhism. You'll often hear Jodo Shinshu referred to as Shin Buddhism. Again, it's just a shorthand. Jodo Shinshu is kind of long. It gets your mouth tired after a while. So it was founded by Shinran, who was a monk in the 13th century. The basic idea here, as Kohara-sensei was saying, is relying on Amida and sort of soaking in the Dharma through the teachings of Mita, Shingon, and other people in the Pure Land tradition. Jodo Shinshu began as a persecuted form of Buddhism in Japan, but over the centuries grew into now the largest single school of Buddhism in Japan. And this is the first organized form of Buddhism that reached the United States. First in Hawaii, which technically we hadn't absorbed yet at the time, and the mainland as well. So a couple of organizations that represented a couple of dates up there. And then I'm going to move on. Okay, so first big question. There's a lot of thought experiment going on in this talk today. So whether you agree or not, let's just think about these as interesting ideas to consider. As I was putting all this together, I started thinking, you know, I wonder, does Buddhism serve a queer function just in a sort of basic way? Buddhism seems to be queer to us in many ways, if we think about this, right? So Buddhism is a very unique form of religion. It challenges Western preconceived ideas about what religion is. People often try to say, well, Buddhism, it's not a religion, it's a philosophy, or it's a way of life, or it's that. All those categories, it challenges. So it's essentially serving this clearing function already, just in its essence, right? So we have here a form of religion that does not have a god, right? People talk about, well, Buddhism's really a type of science, but it's full of all sorts of things that are non-empirical. And really, I would suggest that Buddhism is much more interested in understanding our subjective experience rather than telling us what the objective world is like. Okay? So if it's a science, it's a very subjective science. People say, oh, it's a philosophy. But it's a philosophy that considers ritual practice to be fundamental. So, you know, most people who go to major in philosophy, you know, they don't spend a lot of time doing ritual that I've noticed. And then even notions of the self are definitely queered if we want to take a very liberal definition of that term here. Buddhism suggests that there is no self in any sort of a fundamental way. And this is something which is freaky to a lot of people, but also very true if we really apply the Dharma and discover this for ourselves. So already Buddhism is serving a lot of functions to question things that we are considering, potentially queer them if we want to use the word in that way. All right, I think actually the best place to start would be to talk about Buddhism and sexuality. Hold on a minute. I don't have a clock here that I can see easily, so I'm just going to put my watch here so that I can tell when I'm going over. Doesn't mean I'll stop, it just means I'll feel better. Okay, so Buddhism and sexuality. This is the place to start. It's been observed by many people that Buddhism can actually, in some ways, be defined as a fundamental dualistic relationship between monks on the one hand and householders on the other. Buddhist studies people have for generations said this is the essence of Buddhism, is that separation, which is a separation largely based around uses of sexuality, and then the relationship that develops between those separated classes, with, for example, the monks pursuing rigorous practice, upholding many quite restrictive rules, developing merit, and then the householders who live normal lives but materially support those who are on the other path and benefit because the merit generated by the renunciants is shared with the community, and sort of karma economy that develops from this. Okay? This is not my idea, although that last term is. But this is something people have been suggesting. This is what Buddhism is. Okay, so let's talk about the first side of this, the classic monastic order, sexuality of these things. Okay, so what do we find when we look at the ancient scriptures, at the Pali canon, for example? What we find is that when in discussions of sexuality in Buddhism, they mainly appear within the monastic codes, the codes of behavior specifically. And these are for monks and nuns who are celibate renunciates. All sexuality is forbidden for these people, all types. So what we find is that there are many lists that say you cannot do this and you cannot do that. What do we find? We find that same-sex behaviors are treated in the same way that opposite-sex behaviors are as well. So the Buddha is depicted saying, monks, you cannot have sex with a woman. You cannot have sex with this sort of woman, that sort of woman, because there are all these sort of lists, right? Monks, you can't have sex with a guy. You can't have sex with this kind of guy, that kind of guy, that sort of thing. Monks, you cannot have sex with trees. That's in there, yeah, absolutely. And so I have this graphic up here. Monks, you cannot have sex with a sex doll, is there. You can have sex with a monkey, that's in there too. My favorite one is, you cannot have sex with a hole in the ground. That's in the official rules too, in the Buddhist scriptures. I did not have a good silhouette for that, so I got a tree. I don't know how you would pick a hole in the ground. Basically what it comes down to is, monks and nuns were not supposed to have any sexual behavior at all. Obviously this was a big problem for that because the Buddha had to put all these rules in place. They were, you know, apparently walking by a lot of sexy trees or something. So, and what we find is that all these things are treated equally. So there are cases where they say so-and-so had sex with a woman, this is for a male monk. They said, okay, you have to leave the order in that case. And they said others, oh, so-and-so had sex with a man. Said, okay, you have to leave the order in that case. So they're treated exactly the same way. There's no further sinfulness or some sort of a devaluation which is put on any particular type of sexuality. It's that sexuality is closed off for people who are voluntarily remaining within this monastic order. If they go there, if they can't keep it in their robes, they have to go back into the other category. And that's all that happens. There's no further penalty. There's no suggestion in these codes, oh, you had sex with someone of the same gender as yourself, therefore there'll be these further karmic repercussions or something like that. There's not none of that. It's, okay, you went over the line, so you have placed yourself into the other category. That's actually what it says. It doesn't say you're kicked out. It says you've lost the monkhood by having done that. You're in that category. That's who you are now, okay? And there's no further sort of sense of good or bad around any of this. What about on the other side of it? Outside of the monasteries, there is extremely little commentary on sexuality at all in the Buddhist tradition. There's very little of this, at least around same-sex sexuality, right? So what we find is that it rarely ever comes up. When it comes up, it is never a source of strong concern. It's usually, when we find it, it's just on a list with all sorts of other sorts of behaviors around sexuality that are deemed unskillful. These are things like adultery and so on and so forth, right? The main issue here being that people are violating sort of a monogamous, socially sanctioned relationships, and therefore this is a problem that results from that sort of thing. When we find anything in in historical Buddhist societies that regulates sexuality, including same-sex sexuality, it's always within what we would call civil religious codes. It's not within religious codes. It's just not a topic of religious concern. I want to suggest another thing here that I was thinking about as I was going through this. I happen to be a professor specifically of religious studies and East Asian studies. East Asian Buddhism is my real specialty. And as I was thinking about the reception of Buddhism initially into China, into East Asian society, I started thinking about how Buddhism served a querying function for China. Today, China is an indelibly Buddhist culture, and so we don't think about the way in which China actually was non-Buddhist originally and had a hard time at first accepting Buddhism. As a matter of fact, when Buddhism arrived around 2,000 years ago to China, it was utterly queer from their perspective. Did they use that word? No, obviously. That's an English word that we've sort of recently reclaimed in certain ways. But this is not me reaching here. had they had that word, they would have used it, because that's exactly the way in which they conceptualized what was going on. They looked at Buddhist monks and they said, these people are queer, this is a queer religion, essentially. So the background here is that China at this time was a what we might depict as a Confucian culture. And there was only one acceptable form of sexual orientation, relationship, family structure. All these things were knit together, and these were religious and civil, and all these things together. There was no separation between these things. And that model was a strongly patriarchal model, which suggested that people had to get married, that you were married, of course, according to whom your parents arranged for you, and your real responsibility in life was to have children, and especially sons, and maintain the family lineage. And you as a person were supposed to venerate your ancestors in religious ceremonies, both while they're alive and for the deceased, and you're supposed to continue the family line as part of that piety to the family, and your children in turn would worship you during life and in the afterlife in this way. That was it. There were no other acceptable models. Celibacy was not an acceptable model. And so when Buddhists arrived there, Confucian scholars reacted against this very strongly. They said that Buddhism was a foreign, evil religion, that it was anti-family, that it destroyed morals, that it was calling into question time-honored and self-evident common sense notions of how families and love and relationships and all should be run. That, you know, because monks were venerated, even though they then formed families, they in fact left their families and moved into a separate area that was not a economic sort of a engine or social engine, but was doing its own sort of thing on the side here. That was completely queer and wrong from the Chinese perspective. What happened, though, of course, is that over centuries of dialogue, Buddhism did successfully manage to find a place in China, and China changed because of this. Buddhism changed as well. Buddhism adopted some aspects of the Chinese cultural Confucian model. For example, lineage became very, very important. This is a clear Confucian pickup, you know, so-and-so trained so-and-so, they're almost like their dad, and, you know, this sort of way. You can see some of the Chinese aspects creeping in here. But as much as Buddhism was reshaped by China, China was, to a greater extent, reshaped by Buddhism. This second category of acceptable social arrangement and orientation towards sexuality became fundamental within Chinese society. Chinese society changed. It was successfully questioned and then queered and became something that it wasn't afterwards. Nowadays, this is, you know, no one in China would think that it was odd that someone might pursue a classical monastic sort of way of living. Okay, moving on, same-sex relationships in Buddhist societies. So I said that Buddhism really doesn't have a lot to say about same-sex matters, historically speaking. On the one hand, it does come up in the monastic codes, but just to say, don't do it or anything else, get your hands off the tree, right? On the other hand, for the lay people, there is very, very little commentary. It's not as if I can't go and find somewhere or another a monastic commentary by so-and-so in some century somewhere that mentions this sort of stuff briefly. But when we consider the enormous amount of Buddhist literature there is from the historic tradition in Asia, you have to hunt for years to find anything that refers to it. So what was the actual situation to people who had same-sex orientations, relationships, and so on in Buddhist societies? Well, there's a few things we can say. First of all, there has never been any sort of active persecution of people in Buddhist societies around these issues. That's not at all the same thing as saying that people were totally happy or understanding in this way. Let's be clear, all right? This doesn't mean that everything was a Shangri-La for people if they were gay or if they were non-gender conforming or whatever in their situation. But we have to say that in terms of the religion itself, There was no attempt to find out people's orientation, find out their identity, do anything about it, dehumanize them in some way, put religious or other penalties onto them. These things just didn't happen. Doesn't mean that Buddhists always play nice with each other, but this was not their issue, and it never really came up. So there was never any sort of active persecution. Again, I don't want to suggest this means there was no discrimination. That's just not true. One interesting thing is that we do find occasional instances of same-sex sexuality being actually not only talked about but venerated in some Buddhist societies. The two examples that I know best are Japan and Tibet. So let me mention these, what I'm talking about here. So in Japan, a very interesting thing happened in 14th, 15th, 16th centuries, 17th centuries. There developed a legend that a very famous monk, Kukai, or Kobo Daishi, who was the founder of Shingon in Buddhism, one of the most important historic Buddhist traditions in Japan, a legend developed that he was a lover of like an acolyte, like a novice monk, a youth. And there began to develop not only legends and love poems around this alleged relationship, but this was part of a larger idea. There was a subset of, how would I describe this really? There was a movement, this was certainly a minority movement, but there was a queer movement that suggested that relationships, this was, I have to say, all male, that same-sex relationships were positive and that they were enjoyable, for one thing, this is very clear in the literature, and that monks should actually seek them out. And this was based in the tantric Buddhism of Japan, which already had some sexual aspects to it and which Kukai was the actual founder of. So the legend began and manuals began to be produced that describe how monks could actually seduce and make love to novices. So these would have been sort of teenage or early 20s male youths associated with the monasteries. And these are kind of like Kama Sutras in a way, because they describe how all the different ways to tell, is he into you? Oh yeah, you know, he holds his fan this way. That means he wants to meet you behind, you know, the dining hall tonight, you know, this sort of thing. The rather detailed, they describe actually ways in which you carry out different forms of sex and everything. These are written both for monastic consumption, and there were lay versions that circulated as well. So I don't want to suggest that, therefore, monks all over early modern Japan were totally getting down in this way, but this literature survives. We have still surviving copies of it. We have images. There was actually a best-selling author in early Tokugawa period Japan who wrote a storybook essentially about many love stories between male pairs. There's always males in these things. This is Japan, very patriarchal culture. Many monastic examples in there as well. So that's an interesting sort of thing that developed. Then you get to Tibet. This is even further down the scale, I would suggest. Tibet is the queerest society that has ever existed. I think we can say this objectively, because when we look at their social arrangements, Tibet has opposite gender monogamous marriages. It also has polygamy, where one man will have many wives. It has, it's one of the few societies with a common polyandry, so it's not at all unusual. In fact, it's normal in the rural areas for a woman to have multiple husbands. And then you also had forms of acceptable same-sex relations as well. In particular, there's a social role known as a drombo in Tibet. This is essentially a passive male sexual partner whose own orientation may or may not be towards attraction to males, but who serves as the partner for another male who does have that attraction. Drombos are pretty much an accepted part of Tibetan society and have been present for a long time. One of the most famous places that one finds drumbles or lovers of drumbles is within the Dub Dub group. That's who these people are here. So these guys are referred to as the punk monks. They're a class of monk in Tibet who are kind of they're the roughnecks, essentially. These people served as bodyguards, including the Dalai Lama. They were guards within the monastery to keep people in line, and they formed about 20% of the monastic population. Since Tibet itself had a gigantic monastic population, temples might have easily 10,000 monks in them. That means we're talking about thousands of these punk monks running around, keeping the order, and also doing all sorts of crazy stuff as well. If you know Tibetan Buddhism, just looking at them, you can tell that they're already wearing their hats and their robes in a very flamboyant style. Those hats are sideways. This is like the guy who wears his baseball cap with the bill in the back, right? Those hats are supposed to come forward like this. No way, man. I'm dubbed up. I wear it off the side. They got very, again, you got to be a specialist here, but looking at this, those are punk robes. The way they're wearing it, they're just saying, dude, I do my thing, don't mess with me. These staves here that they have are like basically things they would beat you with if you got out of line. And these guys are very famous for basically cultivating drumbol relationships. And this was just part of Tibetan society. The Dalai Lama's own dance troupe had drumbols in it. And he was protected by a dub bodyguards until he left for India. So this was just part of what was going on there in Tibet. Does that mean that people could get officially married if they were the same sex? No, that sort of legality did not exist in Japan or in Tibet. But acceptance of these as relationships occurring within society was clearly present to a significant degree. Okay, all right, let me move forward to the contemporary situation. What do we find when we look at LGBTQ issues in Buddhism today? Because that's historic stuff. What we find is that homosexuality and same-sex behaviors or actions are mostly legal in Asia. There are a few places where books remain on record, laws remain on books, suggesting that one could not engage in homosexual actions. There's specifically Sri Lanka and Burma. Those are colonial-era British laws that have just never been taken off. In Sri Lanka, they're basically never enforced. Burma, they're not very much enforced, but there has been a rising situation of harassment of people using these laws as an excuse. Burma, as we may know, is sliding into a sort of hyper-nationalist sort of a cultural situation at this time. And unfortunately, what we find is that many people are being targeted as not authentically Burmese as part of this nationalist movement. His strongest targeting Muslims, and they're suffering the most, but among various other groups have also received some targeting now. We have to include LGBTQ people as well. So this is an unfortunate situation in Burma, which is a fairly recent development. Bhutan officially has on the books laws against homosexual activity. Those laws have never been enforced even a single time, and they're talking about, we ought to just get rid of them, so those will probably go. So we have those situations on the one hand. On the other hand, at the opposite end of the spectrum, we have the development, mostly in the West, of temples, Buddhist organizations, and other sorts of Buddhist groupings that are run by people from the LGBT community. And what I think is most interesting is not simply that these aren't merely, say, queer sanghas or something like that, which absolutely there are, but you have major just Buddhist organizations. They're not for any type of person in particular, they're just for everybody, so that you have large bodies of people of all sorts of orientations, including primarily people who are straight, easily, comfortably, willingly having lesbian, gay, transgender, and other sorts of folks as the leaders of their organizations. I actually, to me, that's a stronger endorsement even than people sort of having their own isolated groups. Those also exist, and I'll mention those in a minute. And then, so if those are the two poles, some persecution recently in Burma, and certainly a lot of ignorance in general and some discrimination in Asia. Recently, the development, mostly in North America, of groups led by LGBTQ people. We got everything in between also. So the whole spectrum is basically there. I'm just kind of calling out the poles here. So as a researcher, when I look at Buddhism and I look at queer issues, essentially, what I find is that overall, the situation is one of ignorance. So I would not say that the Buddhist community on the whole is terribly enlightened, pardon the pun, in terms of LGBTQ issues. There's a lot of ignorance out there, and that's kind of the baseline in the Sanghas. That's true regardless of where one goes. We do find instances of genuine discrimination as well, which I put sort of further down the scale from ignorance. This absolutely does occur, it can occur. We may hear personal stories of it today. I'm not sure what people are going to be speaking about. But this is a very real phenomenon. And even though I'm suggesting today in my talk that Buddhism has had overall a remarkably positive sort of or relationship around queer issues, comparatively speaking, that is, I do not want to suggest that there has not been a widespread ignorance and discrimination that has occurred. So we find this in many places, but again, the act of persecution, we just don't find. Even the stuff I'm talking about in Burma, it's a monk or two yelling hateful things on the radio and occasional police bothering someone on the streets. There's no systematic campaign in any sort of way that we found, and there hasn't been one in the past. So ignorance, basically, that's where we're at. Discrimination in some cases, more in the past, it's still absolutely with us in the present. But I also find, as a researcher, just looking into this and talking to people, the tolerance seems to be noticeably increasing in many parts of the wider Buddhist community. So we have sort of all of these as trend lines. All right, let me give you a few examples of contemporary stuff, two different types of examples. First, let's talk about the Dalai Lama as an example of Buddhist figures, important Buddhist figures who have had ignorant points of view in the past and are clearly moving towards more informed and more accepting positions. So, His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama, I probably don't need to tell you who he is, a very famous monk, right? Back in the 1990s, he was asked about Buddhism and, at that time, I believe he was just asked about Buddhism and gay people, was how it was put at that time. And his response was that people should all be well treated, but as for behaviors commonly associated with gay activity, and here he specifically meant anal sex or oral sex, he said that according to the monastic codes, these are improper uses of the organs. And what he meant in that case was that sort of thing, going all the way back to that earlier slide, this is you know, something that monks should not be involved in general, and that these were improper uses regardless of who was using them in that way. So males and females also engaging together in those activities would have been, from his sort of monastic perspective, an improper use of those organs. So this is what I would characterize as a fairly ignorant, traditional standpoint, but one without any intentional malice. People in the LGBTQ activist community went back to him and said, we would like you to further clarify these remarks. We want to have some dialogue with you. And he was open to that dialogue. He heard from people. And over a number of years, his position, his public position, overtly moved. So that now, today, when he's asked about these issues, what he says is that in Buddhism, everyone should be treated equal, well, basically in the world, whether they're Buddhist or not. and that it's important that everyone be accepted. When asked about same-sex marriage specifically, he said that that's something that Buddhist monks should not interfere with. So he has basically come to a relatively accepting standpoint from where he was. This is one of many examples I point to that I found in my research of people who, back in the 70s or 80s, made remarks on the public record, talking about Buddhist leaders, Buddhist monks, and so on, remarks that were not terribly welcoming, but then were engaged in dialogue by activists or people within their own community, and who subsequently changed their remarks. Examples include people like S.M. Goenka, the founder of the Vipassana movement, Mel Weitzman, an important member of the Berkeley Zen community, actually, and many other people who said fairly ignorant things to begin with, and today have moved towards a much more accepting position because they were engaged with productively on these issues, and they decided that they were wrong. So moving towards acceptance, one thing that I see very clear. Then we've got sort of the other side of this, greater inclusivity for people coming from the LGBTQ community. So my example here is someone who will not be as familiar to you. This is Thaimisawan George Chandodamo. He is a monk in the Thai Theravada Sangha. In Thai society, there's an understanding of three genders already, male, female, and katoi, which is categories that never track across cultures. But the closest we could put to this might be a transgender sort of category, or maybe transvestite category, if we're going to use Western terms here. He was a fairly well-known katoi entertainer, and is himself identifies as a gay man. And he decided eventually to retire into the monastic sangha, not an uncommon thing in Thailand. When he did so, he was accepted without difficulty, and he also gave a big-time TV interview about his background and about his experiences now as a gay celibate man within the male monastic sangha. This was like a big TV show. The name's escaping me, but it was like going on Oprah or something. It wasn't just like something on public access TV. The government actually held the talk back for a number of months. They were concerned that this might be inflammatory, because while none of this is technically illegal, either from the religious or the civil standpoint in Thailand, this is a culturally conservative society, and so people were afraid that this would be too uncomfortable a topic. Eventually they decided, no, we can go ahead with it. And in fact, this was then widely broadcast. It brought about discussion, and certainly some conservative monks were disgruntled about all this. There's been no action against him. So he remains as a monk, and this has helped open sort of the Thai attitudes better in this way, right? So if we have the Dalai Lama, the guy on the top, who through successful engagement from queer activists has moved to an accepting position, we also have the other experience of people coming out of the LGBTQ community and moving towards greater involvement and inclusiveness within the long-standing Buddhist structures. Are the situations perfect on either side? Absolutely not, but I think there's clear development from my standpoint as I look at it. Okay, and some of the results of this is that today we have a lot of queer Buddhist resources. So we have queer Buddhist meditation groups, associations, and so on. Here in New York, we've had one from a long time back, at least going back to the 90s. There's the queer sangha that meets down in Shambhala. That's queer sangha. Oh, that's queer dharma, actually, at Shambhala. Queer sangha is another group that goes back at least to the 90s. It used to be Maitri Dorje. Here in New York, there's gay Buddhist fellowships. There's listservs for and websites for people who are Buddhist and transgender, for them to be able to have safe places to discuss with each other. There's not a large number, but a growing number of books that look at these things in particular. The Queer Dharma volumes are a bit old at this point, but they're still good resources, and there's been some other stuff published as well. And, of course, these annual events that the CBE has been putting on, maybe it's been at this point, five, six, at least? Three, soon to be five and six in future years. That's right, okay. I only knew of three, but then someone said something the other day. Okay, right. So these are going on. Hawaii also has done a very public thing as well. So people within the community is trying to hold events, trying to basically, this, if the first two things are about resources for people in the LGBTQ community, Buddhist resources for themselves, I think of these other events that the CBE and Hawaii have put on as consciousness-raising events within the sanghas themselves, the wider, so not the only queer or gay or whatever sanghas, but the wider sanghas raising their consciousness, making sure that people are aware of issues and can treat them responsibly and include people. One result of this has been the BCA temples, in particular marching at pride events that's been going on for a while now. This is San Francisco. Wayne, you're in there, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of dark. Here we go. Okay, so Salt Lake City does that. We'll be doing this on Sunday. There's other temples that have been doing this for a while as well. It's a nice way to get out there into the public and show what's going on. Okay, then same-sex marriage. This is actually the topic of my research, and we have some copies. This is the paper I wrote. There's some copies in the back there. It's easy to find on the internet as well. So what do I want to say about this? Well, what actually got me involved in all this was I was trying to figure out when the first same-sex marriages were held in North America. And that was my original question. And by this, I don't mean two people of the same sex deciding to commit to themselves for life. This is something that's been going on for a long time. I meant clergy, religious representatives, in an actual marriage ceremony presiding, and you know, so somehow the authority of themselves being used to solemnize that relationship, right? When did this begin to occur, I wondered. So as I started to look around, I discovered that it was back in the 1950s are the first examples I could find among the Unitarian Universalists. But I naturally wanted to know about the Buddhists as well. Was this something that was going on just very recently, or did this go back into the past? And as I began to poll people around the BCA and Hawaii and so on, what I found was, first of all, that at the Buddhist Church of San Francisco, the BCA temple, the first BCA temple, same-sex marriages were going on there in the early 1970s already. So we've got 40 plus years of history here, this particular denomination. These are the very first Buddhist same-sex marriages. I don't just mean for BCA, I don't just mean for America. This is the first time that Buddhist, you know, clergy presided over same-sex wedding ceremonies for two people of the same sex. So it was specifically within a Jodo Shinshu context, it was within a BCA context that this occurred. Actually, all of the early examples that I could find were all in BCA temples. So while we can say the first ones were conducted here in San Francisco in the early 1970s, all the other ones from the 70s and early 80s I could find also were in other Shinshu temples. There was an East Coast temple in there too. I'm trying to remember which one from about 1977. Anyway, so the BCA got in on this first, and then from there it slowly began to grow into other places. One very significant event, which some of us are familiar with, was back in 2004, which shockingly was 11 years ago at this point. This was big news at the time, but it's come and gone and become normal at this point. The BCA, at their Ministers Association annual meeting, decided to put out a proclamation making sure it was clear on the public record and to everyone within the temples that they were in support of same-sex relationships and supporting of people who wish to have marriage ceremonies conducted. That was actually because during the this was the election cycle, George W. Bush was up for re-election, and he was using same-sex marriage as a wedge issue to try to get reelected. BCA, the Ministers Association, came out against that and produced this affirming resolution. It was actually sent to the White House, but strangely enough, they chose not to comment. That's way too much to read. Don't worry, I don't expect it. I just threw up a bunch of stuff here from 2010. The Hopahonganji Buddhist Mission of Hawaii. So that's the BCA sister organization for the Hawaiian Islands, also Jodo Shinshu. They, at their annual meeting 5 years ago, produced, this is actually only half of the enormously long resolution, but this was in support of same-sex marriage specifically, as this was being debated. This was in the lead up to Hawaii legalizing civil unions. They came out in support of this, and also generally affirming, they went beyond just that single issue and used it as an opportunity to be widely affirming. Those things are in bold there, because that's the important part I'll come back to. Just an example of BCA same-sex marriage, George Takei, there he is, everybody's favorite Buddhist in America. He grew up in the BCA, and naturally when he was going to get married in 2008, during that window before it was shut down, he had it conducted by Reverend Briones there in Los Angeles at the Japanese American National Museum, which actually used to be the Honganji Temple there. And there he is conducting his ceremony in style. I'm a geek, I just couldn't help it, so I just want to point out, here are the people at his wedding. We got Sulu, Chekhov, and Uhura. If you know Star Trek, you know who they are, I don't have to explain it. If you don't know Star Trek, you're welcome to leave. Alright, other examples from the same sort of time period. This is a picture from the Wheel of Dharma, just showing same-sex wedding, which took place in a BCA temple. It was just a picture that just ran with no real commentary. I actually take that as emblematic of the fact that this is totally acceptable at this point. BCA is essentially the organ of the BCA. Am I making a mistake?
I'm saying that this is the Vaisala Temple, which is a small temple in a very, very conservative part of California.
Yes.
So that's a big statement.
That's right. So thank you. That's very good context. So on the one hand, nationally, this is a big thing by the fact that it wasn't a big thing that could just go in the national BCA newspaper and just go on without any comment. Locally, it is a big thing because this is a culturally conservative area, a relatively conservative temple, and yet, boom, not an issue, or at least not enough of an issue to prevent this sort of thing. Okay, so I'm just using these to illustrate the fact that this isn't even say the early 1970s where you just have kind of some outlier ministers who are willing to perform these things. This is an accepted part of BCA society at this point. And just because I'm from Canada, I got to throw in a shout out to Canada. So last year, World Pride was held in Toronto, and they had a big mass same-sex marriage ceremony. It was an interfaith thing. And the only Buddhist group that was included was the Toronto Buddhist Church, a Jodo Shinshu temple. So Reverend Christina Yanko there in the middle, she was the participant. She actually gave the interfaith blessing, did a sampujo through the paper lotus leaves, and then conducted 10 individual ceremonies in order to make them legal specifically afterwards. So here she is with one of those. I apologize for the photo bomb by the cardinal in the back. Couldn't do anything about that. Okay, so that's the BCA. I just want to point out that as these things have become normative within some American circles, that there's a sort of blowback effect that we're seeing in Asia as well. In Taiwan, just a few years ago, we had the first public known Buddhist same-sex marriage, where you've got a traditional nun, she's from a Chinese Pure Land tradition, marrying two women here. And Japan also is now on the record as well. In fact, this goes even further. There's a temple, don't worry, you don't need to read all that, but this is an ad that I grabbed off the internet with a screenshot to show you. Shunkoin is a Rinzai Zen temple, part of the Myo Shinji complex in Kyoto, And the minister there, he studied in the U.S. for a long time, so he was affected by things here. And he decided that not only was he going to allow same-sex marriages at his temple, but he hit on a money-making scheme. So he is paired with Hotel Grandia, which is a major hotel in Kyoto. He's paired with flower vendors and others there. And so he's part of selling package tours for people to come from all over the world to have a traditional Buddhist same-sex marriage at this Rinzai Zen temple at Miyoshinji. You know, never mind that there's a bit of, let's say, historical revisionism going on here. And it's big. I mean, he's booked all the time. They're making money hand over fist. And, you know, let's face it, in a world of late capitalism, this is how things go mainstream. If you can make a buck off it, suddenly heat just isn't worth the price anymore. So here we go. They're doing this in Kyoto. Okay. Oh, am I here already? I guess I am. I was going to do something else. I have a slide I didn't know was in place. Let's shift gears for a minute. Here, I'll get into my, going back to my thought experiments. And I think I have about 10 or 15 minutes before I need to stop for Q&A, so I won't go too much further. But I want to throw something out for us to consider. And that is, I want us to consider whether Shingon, the founder of Jodo Shinshu, might, from a certain perspective, be seen as the first queer icon in Buddhist history. I have very specific reasons for bringing this up, and this is something I have not discussed publicly before. This is just something I've been thinking about as I was putting this together. So you all let me know whether I'm on the right track or not. Here's what I was thinking. So Shinran is a very particular figure in the history of Buddhism. Not just in Japanese Buddhism, in Buddhism as a whole. Shingon is a person who, while a monk, was part of the early Pure Land community in Japan. They were persecuted by the government. And the government, which legally controlled ordinations in Japan, took away his ordination, told him he was a criminal. This was because of his involvement in the Pure Land community, and sent him into exile. While he was in exile, he married a woman and had a family. The thing is, Shingon continued to consider himself as a monk of a type, at least. He was no longer an official monk, and he was now married. He was now raising a family. On the other hand, he was not a normal layperson either. He was not falling into those two categories, the monastic or the householder. He wasn't either. He specifically says, he says, "So ni arazu, zoku ni arazu." I'm neither a monk nor a layman. He has no place in either category anymore. In other words, he's queer by the standards of 13th century Japan. I don't think there's any more accurate way to describe this. He's a married monk. He's still a monk. He shaves his head, he wears the robes, he chants the sutras, he teaches the Dharma. These are monastic activities. These continue after the exile, after the marriage. On the other hand, he is married, he does have a family, he raises children, grandchildren. It's fact from his family lineage that the Honganji tradition arises and leads us to have this temple here today. If he hadn't been married, it's not clear whether this would have survived as a tradition and whether this community would still exist. By the standards of Buddhism of his age, he is a gender criminal. I don't think this is hyperbolic to say this. This is not something we really talk about when we think about Shingon. We're all aware that he got married, we're aware that he bridged that gap, but because for 800 years we've been doing this, and it's so normal within this community to have married ministers, we don't realize how queer this really was. We realize it was radical for the time, but we don't really think through the full implications of that. So I want to suggest that he serves as an interesting sort of queer Buddhist icon. And then, just to turn up the temperature on this issue a little further, I'm just going to go ahead and go there as long as I'm going there. I want to point out that Shingon's wife was a man. So there's an interesting situation here. Again, this is all from a certain perspective. But what happened is that Qinran spent 20 years of his life up top of Mount Hiei training as a Buddhist monk, as a celibate Buddhist monk. He became disillusioned and he came down to a chapel called Rokkakudo in Kyoto and began a sort of last-ditch intense training effort. This Rokkakudo is a chapel dedicated to Prince Shotoku Taishi, the very important historical figure in Japanese Buddhism. The prince was essentially in charge of the government during part of his lifetime. And he was himself a devout Buddhist who brought Buddhism much further into Japanese society at an early time in its development. So Shotoku Taishi was the object of devotion in this chapel. And Japanese tradition had built up a legend that Shotoku Taishi, Prince Shotoku, was himself an emanation of the Bodhisattva Kanon, Kanon Bosatsu. This is Avalokiteshvara, the Bodhisattva of Compassion, if you happen to know the Sanskrit name. So this is a Bodhisattva who can appear in many forms. And one form that the Bodhisattva appeared in historically, it was believed, was as Prince Shotoku. So Qinran went to this chapel and he locked himself inside for 100 days. And he did a very intense practice where he would walk around the statue of the prince, the Bodhisattva prince, chanting the name of Amida Buddha, and without stopping, trying not to sleep, trying not to do anything else. Of course, you have to have a few rest periods and this sort of thing, but very, very intense practice, hoping to find some way through this sort of, if we might say, existential crisis he was experiencing. He got an answer on day 95, so he essentially completed it. What happened is that he had a vision. Prince Shotoku appeared to him and said, these are the words recorded by the tradition that have been handed down to him. The prince, as the Bodhisattva, appeared and said, since it is your karma to have sex with women, I will become your wife. I will be your wife on companion, and when you die, I will help take you to the Pure Land. So this is a paraphrase, but that's essentially how we would translate these things, right? And this revelation is believed to be what gave Qinran his willingness to go to Honan's Pure Land community, to become involved there, and go decisively down the Pure Land path. This led to eventually the exile, the marriage, the creation of Jodo Shinshu, all these things, right? Was this moment of this vision that he had. We're well aware that he married a Shini, but we don't think about the fact that he thought that she was not just a woman that he married. He thought that this was an emanation of Kanon Bodhisattva, who had agreed to marry him as part of his path to liberation. And that Kanon had come to him in the form of a male who was going to marry him and be sexually involved with him and take him to the Pure Land. Now, this is more complicated than just male-female, because Kanon is not essentially male or female. And he did not marry a man, he married a woman, a Shini. Nonetheless, I just want to point out that there's this very complicated fluidity going on here around this partner that Qinran allied himself with. So, just a thing for us to think about. Now we'll move on. Okay, gender fluidity in Buddhism. This is what I wanted to talk about. I have really interesting things to say about it. I wonder if I should stop. No? Okay. All right. Having lobbed my most inflammatory fireball right then, I'm now given permission to move on. Okay. Gender fluidity. Here we go. I'll try to treat this quickly, even though this is something we could spend a week on. But quickly enough, gender fluidity is assumed within Buddhist philosophy. If you do not assume gender fluidity, Buddhism does not make any sense at all. So according to normative, basic, mainstream Buddhist philosophy, beings have no inherent gender. They have no inherent race. They have no inherent identity. People are circulating time and again through this world in many different forms with many different lifestyles over an infinite amount of time. Okay? all beings have been our mothers, all beings have been our fathers, all beings have been our children, our sons, our daughters, everything else that's possible, according to basic Buddhist viewpoints. Every single male has also been female. Every single female has also been male. Every single female has also been intersex, has been transgender, has been everything else, every male. Everybody has been everything possible because there's no essential core to beings. If there's an infinite amount of time that we're talking about here, an infinite amount of relationships. Okay? This means that Justice Alito of the Supreme Court has been your gay husband at some point in the past. Everything, every possible combination has taken place if we take this philosophy at face value. We got Kanon again, gender-bending bodhisattva. All bodhisattvas and Buddhas can appear in whatever form they want. Kanon seems to go out of the way to take on a lot of different forms. There's 33 ones that are traditional in China. This is a bodhisattva who started out as typically depicted male in India, but by the time China, the most patriarchal society there ever has been, got done with him, he was a girl. So, go figure. This shows the real sort of gender bending that is possible within Buddhism. And these are Buddhist spiritual exemplars who are just putting on male, female, whatever form they need. Whatever form people need, that's the form they take for them. So our bodhisattvas are whatever we need them to be, essentially. I'll speed this up because I really have used most of my time. The sutras are full of examples of beings who switch their genders. For example, in the Vimalakirti Sutra, it takes place in a Buddhist pure land of Vimalakirti in his house, which is a pure land. And there's a goddess there, and there's a high-ranking monk. The monk says, "Whoa, you know the Dharma so well. So why are you still a girl?" Okay, patriarchal Indian Buddhism here. And she says, "Clearly you're stuck on something. Let me help you with this." This is a paraphrase of the story. So it's just using her, goddess magic, switches bodies with him. He freaks out. She says, "So why don't you just change your body?" It's like, "Oh man, I can't find my masculinity anymore," because he's in a female body now. And God says, "Yeah, when you really understand the Dharma, all that stuff, you're beyond all that stuff, and you can easily take on whichever form is comfortable and necessary, so you don't get stuck in thinking this or that this way." So this is a case where the monk is educated through this. Lotus Sutra has a similar sort of thing. Larger Pure Land Sutra also deals with gender shifts as well. I'll just have to skip that though because I'm so short on time. I'll mention Shinran also. Shinran bowed to male statues of Amida Buddha, but in his writings often refers to Amida as a compassionate mother. So obviously gender is fluid in his understanding of that figure as well. Gender in the skandhas. Gosh, I really just have too much material. I'm going to say very quickly, the basic Buddhist understanding of human beings and people is that they have no essential core but are made up of five skandhas or aggregates. These are shifting things, they're changing all the time. The physical body is one of them, also your sensations, your perceptions, and so on. Because all of these are interacting with each other but are not fully dependent on one another, it's very easy to assume from a Buddhist philosophical standpoint that, for example, one's body that one's born into might be sexed as male, but another one of the skandhas that one is composed of, say your mental formations, might be gendered as female, right? So this is just a fairly obvious thing that follows on from Buddhist society. And therefore, I would go further and suggest that therefore, if one finds that one skandha and another skandha are conflicting and that their level of comfort is made best by altering a skandha in order to conform to what they feel is most genuine to themselves, there's just absolutely nothing in Buddhism that suggests this is a problem in any way. There's actually transgender incidents that occur within the early Buddhist scriptures where through the power of the divine figures, so-and-so who is born male or born female, there's a couple instances, decides that they're one or the other, and they get switched over, and then all that happens. The only consequence is they were a monk, but felt that they were a woman. Then they were transformed into a female. So now they join the nun's order instead. And there's an example going back the other way. So notice there's no stigma here whatsoever, as long as people are sort of being celibate in that situation because they're monks. This particular denomination that we're a part of has explicitly affirmed the value of transgender people. This is something I turned up in my research. There had been an instance where a woman and a trans woman were trying to be married at one of the LA area temples. The minister there was totally willing to do it, but decided to consult the head temple in Japan just to see what their opinion was. And they returned the opinion that everyone is equal and they have no objections to these people or to these relationships, so long as the people are authentically involved in Buddhism and genuinely wish to be partners. So as long as it wasn't a political show, but was actually about their love, their relationship, Hongwanji was totally fine with this. I was going to suggest why Shin Buddhism is really good about this. I don't really have time. One thing I think is the internment camps. This community has faced historically a lot of racial and religious persecution. I think that makes people have a certain level of revulsion towards any sort of discrimination. The main thing, though, is theology, essentially. Amida Buddha saves all beings without any exceptions. Shimon talks about how Amida saves the good and the bad, the rich and the poor, the young and the old, the male and the female. And every minister that I talk to on the subject said, and obviously, therefore, saves you gay or straight as well, whatever. It's all good from Amida's standpoint, and so our job is to get to that standpoint as well. This is what every single minister I hold said. So, I'll just have to go through that quickly. Oh, yeah, Rainbow Wages, that was really quick. I learned from Elaine that these rainbow wages, the wages is actually a form of the monastic rite that is worn in this tradition. These rainbow ones once belonged to the Smithsonian, now demonstrating the Buddhist community's support for LGBT issues. So that's it. This is my takeaway slide. I just wanted to make the points that queer people of various types have been present in Buddhism from the beginning, are still present. Buddhism has at times served a function of queering society. At the same time, there have been other times when after-Buddhism is established and then contributes to sort of hegemonic discourse as it becomes dominant in society. So Buddhism has played both roles. I like to think that Buddhism operates at its best when it serves in a challenging or progressive mode. But that's me speaking as a Buddhist rather than a researcher. There's very significant resources in Buddhism for having positive attitudes and understandings of people around gender orientation, around sexual orientation, gender identity, and many other things. I've examined some of those. There's actually much more to say about these sort of things. Shin Buddhism has not a perfect record. I don't suggest that. I can make your stories that would suggest that today. But objectively looking at the facts, it's definitely the winner in terms of how the overall record on LGBTQ concerns. There's not even really a second runner-up, what I found from my research. But that said, other Buddhists are also making substantial progress. By the turn of the millennium, American Zen, Theravada, Tibetan, and Soka Gakkai communities had all also performed same-sex marriages at some point. You didn't have the sort of widespread denominational phenomenon or the sort of denominational official messages yet, but people in those, you know, individuals in those groups were doing it already. And at this point, it's become a much more accepted sort of thing now, another 15 years on. So, that's my death march through queer and Buddhist history. Thank you for sitting through it. We have about 10-12 minutes, yep. And I'm very interested to hear what you guys have to say.
We have anyone out here initially with some questions? Jeff, I'd like you touched. You said you didn't have time. Some of the reasons, but that mm-hmm. if you could just basically a couple of the reasons why Shin is so has been historically open-hearted.
Okay.
Obviously, well, I'll let you go ahead.
Sure. Okay. Very good. All right. So I think it's multiple complicated things. I'm sorry. I'm a scholar. I'm a historian. I can't ever stop thinking that. Oh, it's this and that. You know, it's very complicated, right? But there's several things I want to highlight in particular. One is, like I said, the history of discrimination that Shin communities have experienced automatically made many people more willing to extend an open-mindedness towards others, okay? So the Shin community was never persecuted around sexual issues or orientation issues or anything like that. But when those issues became part of public awareness within the Shin communities, it wasn't that difficult for them to move from a historic sort of anti-racist viewpoint into also accepting this. I should also sort of qualify that as well. To say that Shin Buddhists haven't been racist is not true either, okay? People who have experienced discrimination are also totally able to give discrimination towards others within their own groups. That said, and while there really has been racial discrimination within Shin communities, as it has been, unfortunately, within all American Buddhist communities, really I should say, within all American communities, this is a problem in the total culture, right? And Buddhists are not immune to this. At the same time, there have also been progressive efforts from very early. Sometimes these were, frankly, dissidents within the community, and there are times that the totality of the denomination was with them. I'd like to think that we're moving in the right direction on that issue as well. But in general, having experienced systematic oppression, it did make people at least willing to open their mind in this direction. I think that's a big part of it. Another thing is that we've got married ministers, so we already have a lifestyle closer to everybody else than a celibate monk or a nun locked up in a monastery somewhere, right? We're already living amongst the people and living like the people. And so that means that we have a greater sensitivity to the issues people have and that we don't have the same sort of hang-ups around sex, frankly. Furthermore to that, even, because we allow our ministers to have relationships, that means that inevitably that we're going to be LGBTQ ministers as well. Now, there's gay monks and gay nuns and all sorts of things in other forms of Buddhism, but they're celibate. They can't live, that part of themselves can't be lived out in the same way that a straight person can't live that part of their life out either as a monk or a nun. But we believe that people can live out that side of themselves and still retain a clergy function. And so therefore that meant inevitably people were going to come into the minister's roles. Obviously this was in a closeted situation at first, but once people begin to come in, they begin to affect the people around them, change is basically inevitable. And so I think that helped along with things. The fact that we've been doing marriages for a long time, Buddhist marriage is itself a recent innovation. But we've been doing it for 100 years in this country. So, whereas it took a while for Tibetans and Zen people to start saying, whoa, should we do this marriage thing? We'd already been doing it for 3 generations before they started having that conversation. So just switching it over to, oh, now it could be 2 guys or two women, that was a much smaller shift than should we even do marriage in the first place, which is what everyone else was grappling with during the 70s and 80s. And then I do just really want to come back to, those are historical reasons why this community might be first. It's because we were first in many ways. Some of the first Buddhists here, so some of the first to experience the racial and religious discrimination, some of the first to have to deal with issues around relationships, and the first ones that to have to perform marriages, because the clergy marriages are expected in the North American culture. So that's part of it, we just happened to be here first, and so we just happened to get through the milestones first. But there is also this other side of it, which is inherent to this form of Buddhism specifically. Other forms of Buddhism also stress compassion. They also share some of these things with us, and people in other Buddhist communities have called forward those resources to help them to move in accepting directions too. But even though there is that overlap there, and I want to make sure other Buddhist communities are given their due, at the end of the day, there's something different about Shin Buddhism. It is unique in a variety of ways, and that real philosophy of absolute total inclusivity and the primal vow of Amida is something that one doesn't find elsewhere in other forms of Buddhism. And also that the fact that most forms of Buddhism are about improving yourself, ever improving until you reach Buddhahood, but Jodo Shinju has an inverse form of practice. We focus on ourselves and discover ever more just how limited we are. And so if you have a basic orientation in religion towards being skeptical towards yourself and towards not giving yourself sort of the gold star for being the awesome Buddhist, that automatically means you have basically no foundation upon which to point fingers to other people. So if I just were to change the conversation and say, let's say we don't like queer people and we want to throw them out of Jodo Shinshu Buddhism, I can't think of how you could build such an argument. There's just nothing there to build it upon. So it really is just kind of a natural thing over time. Anyways, that's how I see this coming about, through all these sort of interacting pieces.
Very good, thank you. Yeah. Any other questions?
I've got 5 minutes to buy my watch.
I thought it was a great presentation, thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
I was wondering if you've given this presentation or a similar presentation to the BCA ministers, and if so, what has their reception been to this idea of a queer history of Buddhism?
I never said any of this before today, so you are the debut audience. The only thing is, so my research on same-sex marriage in Buddhism, especially American Buddhism, primarily the BCA and the Hawaii temples, that is a published thing. It was published in 2012, and I gave a scholarly presentation in 2011 in San Francisco at the American Academy of Religion annual conference. There was at the Queer Studies group at their session there, where I debuted some of that piece of the research. All this stuff is, you know, Buddhism is a queer religion. Shinran is a queer Buddhist icon. A lot of the details in here, skandhas and all that sort of stuff, that's all fresh from today. So
you're just trying it out on this first.
Yeah, you guys are getting
this.
Yeah. If it flops like, here, I'll just put it in the back file and that's it. But the truth of the matter is, I'm the invited speaker for the Buddhist Studies Center in Hawaii. Their summer sessions for next year. They do sort of a week or 2 weeks of sessions, and I'm going to be the speaker there. I'm toying with, I think my topic is going to be engaged Shin Buddhist practice, and I was thinking that this might be one day of talk there, along with other topics, to further develop some of these ideas. So it begins here, but I may talk about this more widely in the future.
Jeff Sensei is going to be here for the day, so we're going to try to stay on schedule because we have a lot of speakers, jam-packed program. Thank you so much. That was an amazing presentation.
Thank you very much.